Hello everyone, thank you for joining us today and welcome to our live webinar, Customized In Vivo Electrophysiology from the Simplest to the Most Complex. My name is Diane Royer. I am the Marketing Manager at Neuro Services Alliance, and I will be moderating today's webinar. This live event is part of our 2021 Innovation Series that will focus on showcasing our member innovative assays and technologies. Every webinar will be presented by one of our neuroscientist experts. Also, we know that your time is valuable, and this is why our events all follow today's format: 20-minute presentation followed by 10 minutes of live question and answer. If you have any question at any time of the presentation, please submit them in the question box that is located on the bottom of the GoToWebinar panel. Also, this session will be recorded, and you will receive the full recording after the live session. However, I strongly encourage you to stay until the end, as it is the occasion to have our speaker answer your questions live. Before starting, let me just say a few words about Neuro Services Alliance for those of you who don't know us. We are a consortium of CNS CROs specialized in vitro and in vivo electrophysiological and behavioral studies. Our goal is to deliver endpoints facilitating decision-making to our clients for their CNS drug discovery programs. We value direct and efficient interaction with our clients, and we rely on a team of more than 50 PhD scientists. As a speaker, we have Dr. Cyril Herry with us today. Cyril is Research Director and Co-Coordinator of OptoPaths. As a member of Neuro Services Alliance, OptoPaths is a platform dedicated to innovative experimental research in CNS psychopathologies. Hello, Cyril, and I will let you take the lead from here.
Hello everyone and welcome to this webinar on in vivo electrophysiology. So first to start, I would like to present the OptoPath platform and myself. I'm a research director at INSERM and I'm co-coordinator of the OptoPath platform, which is an in vivo electrophysiological platform that is designed to record in behaving animals neuronal signals, and I will detail that in a moment. As I mentioned, we eventually perform behavior in, simultaneously to the neuronal recordings, and we are also expert in analyzing neuronal signals. And to achieve this task, the platform is equipped with multiple recording systems. So we have 7 Plexon systems, 64-channel system. We have many other systems like Intan and Blackrock system as well. And we have dedicated space and resources. We can host mice and rats, male and female. We can host 240 rats and 600 mice. We have around 400 square meters of experimental space, and we have a dedicated team of technicians and researchers to help you on your project. The average timeline for electrophysiological experiment is about 6 to 10 weeks for recording, let's say, 8 to 12 mice. And we can record those animals, in particular local field potential, during several weeks and months. So today I will, in this webinar, I will first describe the methodology we are using to record neuronal signals. And I will briefly detail what are those signals and how we can extract them. The second part will be devoted to analysis, and I will describe simple and more complex analysis and what exact information we can extract from the recording signals. And the first part will be a study case, and I will show you how the use of the combination of single units recording and local field potential recordings help us to identify a physiological biomarker of defensive states in the prefrontal cortex of rodents. So let's start with the methodological section. As I said a bit earlier, either in mice or rat, we can perform different kind of recordings. In particular, we can perform a surface electrode recording when the electrode is at the surface of the brain, or these are called EEG or EcoG when they are performed above the cortex. We can also perform deep electrode local field potential recordings in different structure. And usually we can couple these LFP recordings with single units recording in dedicated structures. We use many types of electrodes. For the EcoG, EEG use tungsten electrode. For the local field potential and units recording, we use custom-made nichrome electrodes. We can use tetrodes, tetrodes, depending on the structure, but also manufacture silicon probes. We usually can record several structures simultaneously, and those recordings can be associated with muscular recordings. We can do those recordings during behavior or using head-fixed preparation, either anesthetized or awake. So when it comes to a signal you record in the brain, this is a raw signal you can record from a deep structure in the brain. And as you can see on these traces, we can record simultaneously fast events that are action potentials that are surrounding some slow events that are the local field potential. So just as a proxy, the action potential, they reflect the output activity of the neurons, their action potentials. The local field potential, in contrast, represent the global activity of the structure, in particular, represent the synaptic inputs to the structure. So we have a different readout when looking at spikes versus local field potentials. Just to mention that, we can also combine those recordings with optogenetics and pharmacology. So what can we do with those raw signals? If we concentrate on those signals collected into the brain, we can segregate fast and slow events by applying different filtering. We can, for instance, get local field potentials that are slow events if you apply a downsampling of below 500 hertz. In contrast, spikes events are fast events above 300 hertz, and you using a high pass filter, you can segregate those two signals. So on the one hand, the LFP or EEG, and the other hand, the local field, the spiking activity. So if we concentrate a bit on the single cell activity, the global idea here is to record in the vicinity of some neurons, as shown in this example. You have an electrode that is within the brain and that can record the extracellular activity of different neurons that are color-coded in this example. So each neuron will fire action potential with a particular shape, as on this example, on this picture. And as you can see, there is this constancy of the shape of the action potential depending on the neuron you are recording from. And based on this shape constancy, you can apply a mathematical transformation in 2D or 3D dimension, and you can plot cluster of action potentials that correspond to a single neuron. So in a sense, you follow the single spiking activity of these neurons during time. At the same time, you do this spike sorting, which is quite time consuming. We also check for the cluster quality by looking at refractory periods, check that within a cluster we have similar waveforms, that we are not recording from different from the same single units over different wires, and so on and so forth. Still on the methodology, when you record, when you do the spike sorting, after the spike sorting, you end up with a matrix like this one, where each line represents the neuron, and there is a color code here that represents the firing activity of each neuron in relation to an external stimulus, like in this particular case, it was a sound, but it could be any electrical stimulation, drug injection, whatever. So what you look at here on each line is a single neuron, and you can see that after the stimulus onset, some neurons will display increase in activity or decrease in activity. And basically what you can simply do is look in time around the presentation of the stimulus, the changes in the firing activity of the excited neuron, the significantly active neuron, or the significantly inhibited neuron, as in this particular case. So this is for the methodology. So we have two signals, and the LFP in the one hand, and spiking activity in the other hand. And the question here is, how can we analyze those signals? So in the follow-up slide, I will present different kind of analysis, from the simplest to the more complex one. The more simplest one, we call them the static analysis. And I will start with the EEG, EKG, LFP recordings. So EEG, EKG is for surface recording, LFP for deep recordings. So the most simplest analysis we can do is what we call a power spectrum. Basically, you plot the amplitude of the oscillation you record into the brain as a function of the frequency. And what it gives is an indication of the preferred oscillation frequency or the frequency range of a given structure. In this particular example, you have two, let's say, behavioral situation, on and off situation. And what you can see is that on the on situation, you have a peak of oscillatory activity around 5 Hertz in the brain in comparison to the off situation where you don't see that. So you can pick up specific oscillatory band during particular behavioral epochs or following drug injection, stimulation, and so on and so forth. This is the first one. The second analysis is called the evoke field potential. This time you look at the changes in the amplitude of the local field potential as a function of a stimulation that could be a sensory stimulation or again a drug injection or an electrical stimulation. And these give you an indication of the net effect of your particular stimulation on the synaptic inputs to a given structure. So now if we go to the spike, to the single units and try to identify static analysis, simple analysis. The first one you can do is simply an average of the firing rate of the neurons depending of if they are activated or inhibited, like in this particular example. And you can compare the changes in the firing activity between two conditions before and after a drug injection, for instance. And you can observe neurons that are activated following the drug injection or inhibited following the drug injection. So these are all the neurons you can record in a particular structure. But of course, for some of you, it might be interesting to analyze differentially whether some excitatory cell or inhibitory cell, the interneurons, behave differently in response to the stimulation. So using extracellular feature, we can isolate putative excitatory from putative inhibitory interneurons. And basically what we use is we extract from the action potential the half spike width and the area under the curve, which is an indicative of the after hyperpolarization. And if you plot that in a 2D space, you can isolate the excitatory neuron and the putative inhibitory neuron. And as you can see on this pie chart, as expected from this cortical recording, we have a majority of excitatory neuron and a minority of inhibitory neuron. So again, with this segregation, you can come back to the average firing rate and look whether the excitatory neuron or the inhibitory neuron are more influenced by your manipulation, drug injection, again, sensory stimulation, and so on and so forth. So now it could be also interesting to go to a bit more complex analysis that we call the dynamic analysis. And if we concentrate on the EEG, EKG, or LFP, it might be of interest for some of you to look at the changes in the amplitude of the oscillation as a function of time. And this kind of plot is called a spectrogram, where you look in color to the amplitude of the oscillation as a function of time and also as a function of the oscillatory band. So in this example, you see a strong oscillation around 4 Hertz during a certain amount of time. So this gives you an indication of the preferred oscillation frequencies in a given structure over time. Now we can eventually look at a more complex analysis that we call cross-frequency spectrum, and I will detail that right now. So on this top spectrogram, what you can see is gamma oscillation that have been recorded in the prefrontal cortex. And if you look into detail into those gamma oscillation, you can see different components of the gamma oscillation. So we have a high component that is called the high gamma with a peak frequency around 80 Hertz and the low gamma here that with a peak frequency around 60 Hertz. So it seems to have two components in this gamma oscillation. So first, if you compute the correlation between the peak high and peak low gamma, what you see is an inverse correlation indicating that they are invertly correlated. And you can look at that also using the cross frequency spectrum, which is kind of interesting, where you plot the frequency of the two oscillations against each other. And you look at the correlation coefficient of the peak frequency. And what you can see on this graph is that they are highly anti-correlated. And this is shown in this dark spot here, when you see we have 100 high gamma stimulation is not occurring when you get 60 Hertz oscillation, that is low gamma oscillation. So they are mutually exclusive. So that's kind of interesting relation, dynamical relation you can observe between LFP bands. And this can be done within a particular structure, but also within between structures. So turning to the spiking activity, you also may want to analyze those signals dynamically. And here on this example, this is an injection of a GABA antagonist in the prefrontal cortex while we were recording single unit activity. And as you can see, we can observe a dramatic increase in the firing frequency of the neurons when you block the inhibition in vivo in this particular preparation. So we can get access to the changes in firing frequencies over time with this preparation in single units recording as well. So now, when you consider single units recording, it can be also interesting for some of us to evaluate monosynaptic interaction between pairs of neurons. Because you record many neurons simultaneously, you can compute what we call cross-correlogram. And basically, a cross-correlogram, you take in reference as zero the firing activity of the neuron in red, and you look around the firing activity of the neuron in red, how the other neuron is reacting. And in this particular left example, you see that each time the neuron in red is firing, you see this activation of the neuron in blue just after, which is an excitatory cross-correlation. And this occurs within a few milliseconds, which indicate that this is monosynaptic interaction. Sorry, I am moving too fast. You can get the opposite cross-correlogram, that is an inhibitory cross-correlogram. This time you see a strong inhibition after the firing of the neuron in blue, and which indicate that the neuron in blue is inhibitory, as an inhibitory action onto the neuron in red. And this can be of interest for you to see if a particular drug injections change this interaction between neurons within a particular structure. Following up with the dynamic analysis, one might be interested in looking at the synchronization of the signals between two different regions or three different regions. I will give you an example about the ECOG, and later on we'll talk about the spiking activity. So in this particular example, we're recording local field potentials, both simultaneously in the prefrontal cortex and the amygdala. And during fear conditioning, and we observe during defensive state that the two oscillations were highly synchronized, as you can see on this example. So there was a high temporal synchronization, but also a phase synchronization when you look at the pie chart that display the different in phase of the two signals. So these synchronization can occur during behavior or in reaction to any drug injection, drug compound, external stimulation. Now, when you have these two signals, it might be interesting to look in a different way at their synchronization, and you can look at the coherence between the two signals. So if you compute what we call a coherogram here on the left, what you can see is how coherent are the two signals during a particular amount of time. And that you can see when the animal is in this particular defensive state, which is a classical freezing reaction, what you see is that the two signals are highly coherent. So you can see that also in terms when you plot the same thing, but as a function of the frequency, we see this sharp increase in the coherence activity around 4 to 5 Hertz. And from those data, you can also compute the directionality of the interaction, namely whether the prefrontal cortex can lead the amygdala or whether it is the amygdala that leads the prefrontal cortex. And in this particular example, what you see is that we observe, this analysis is called a Granger causality analysis. And in this analysis, we saw a surge in 4 Hertz oscillation considering the input from the prefrontal cortex to the BLA, indicating that what is leading is the prefrontal cortex in this particular case. Turning to spiking activity, besides single cells activity, we can also consider the global activity of the neurons, what we call population coding. So you may have synchronized activity among neurons, or you may have neurons displaying a temporal pattern of activity, which is called a temporal code. So we'll first describe the population code, and later on during the study case, I will describe more the temporal code. So this is interesting because you take the entire activity, spiking activity of the structure as a reference, and you can look how the global organization, the global population of the neurons fire in time in response to different events. So I will give you an example to show you, to explain that to you. What we have done in this example, we have looked at the population activity of the neurons. So let's say we took 100 neurons, we compute instantaneous population vector that for a particular bin of time represent the global activity of the structure we are recording, and we plot this population vector in a 2D or 3D dimensional space. So in the particular task I will describe, it was fear conditioning, and we teach the animal to that a sound, a particular sound that we call the CS plus, was associated with the food shock. And we have a control sound, the CS minus, that was not associated with the food shock. So in the 3D space in this example, what you see, each line corresponds to a single trial when we presented in gray the CS minus, or in color the CS plus, and the CS plus could be associated with an avoidance response or not an avoidance response. So in green is an avoidance response, in orange is a non-avoidance response. And we look at the dynamic of those population in time at the time of the CS onset. So now I will show you a video to show how it looks like. And in this video, you see that we play the CS at zero. We play the CS onset, and you will see that at the beginning, the cluster are all together, but as soon as you play the sound, the cluster move apart, and the CS minus being far away the CS plus cluster, indicating that in terms of population, we can decode the sound that is associated with food shock from a sound that is not associated with the food shock. And you can apply exactly the same analysis after a drug injection or any other stimulation. So this is quite interesting because it gives you an information of the at the global level, at the global population level. So coming back to the dynamic analysis, some of you might be interested in analyzing a brain state, and we can do that from EEG recording from different structure. And let's say if you put an electrode in the prefrontal cortex and the hippocampus, you can record on these two spectrograms different oscillatory bands. But if you look at the choreogram between these two structures, you end up with this kind of choreogram that can help you to disentangle different brain states, like wakefulness from different sleep stages. So on this choreogram, at the beginning, when you see this eye coherence that is distributed in terms of frequency, this corresponds to awake events. And as soon as you get a slow oscillation here, this corresponds to slow wave sleep. And you can also pick up REM episode here, which are represented by the eye coherence between the two signals around the theta frequency. So with this technology, we can segregate sleep from wake state, and within sleep we can isolate REM from slow wave sleep states. These are simply examples of the different traces you can see during slow wave sleep and REM. And if you record in the dorsal hippocampus or the ventral hippocampus, you can eventually collect record sharp wave ripples that are interesting, because these sharp wave ripples have been shown to be increased during slow wave sleep after learning. So it could be an indication of a learning episode or the influence of a particular compound on a learning episode. So it might be interesting for some of you to record also sharp wave ripples that are prominent during slow wave sleep. There is a different marker of memory processes in the form of sleep spindle that have been associated with consolidation processes as well. So to record sleep spindle, you need to do a perfect analysis. What you need to do is to record local field potential in the given structure, let's say the prefrontal cortex, in addition to spiking activity. And when you combine those two signals, you can, and in particular, if you look at the spiking activity, you can isolate upstate from downstate in white, and the upstate are in pink. And it is known that the slow wave sleep occur mainly, the sleep spindles occur during slow wave sleep, but during upstate mainly. So this is and you can see that on the spectrogram, where you see these sleep spindles around 12 Hertz that are prominent during a slow wave sleep in up state. So this is important to record both LFP and spike in this case, because you can disregard false positive that could be recorded during the down state. Okay, this is the analysis we can perform at the Octopath platform, and now I would like to give you an example of an application that was really helpful for us to identify a physiological biomarker of defensive state. The behavioral model we have been using in this study case is auditory fear conditioning. So animals were implanted with electrodes in the prefrontal cortex and the amygdala, and the behavioral model was really simple. We use auditory fear conditioning, so the animal learned that the CS is associated with the food shock, and the next day when you present the CS alone, they display a typical defensive response, which is an immobilization response we call the freezing. So when we record the local field potential in the prefrontal cortex, we observe that during freezing episode, we observe the emergence of this slow oscillation that you can see on the spectrogram that are centered around 4 Hertz. And these 4 Hertz oscillation, they start before the initiation of the freezing episode and they stop before the end of the freezing episode. And using a machine learning algorithm, we try to predict whether the emergence of those oscillations were predictive of the defensive state. And in 80% of the cases, it was predictive. So it's really a strong signal indicating that you are likely to be in a defensive state. Okay, this was the first part. Because we combined those LFP recordings with single unit recordings, we also identified group of neurons that are represented in color here that were firing in the prefrontal cortex, mainly in the ascending phase of the oscillation. And this was quite interesting for us because they form a kind of neuronal assembly, specifically during the ascending phase of the oscillation. The idea we had at this time was to try to block those excitatory neurons firing in the ascending phase of the oscillation using mainly two different approaches. We use optogenetic combines to single units recording or deep electrical stimulation of the brain. And both of these methodologies were based on the following strategy. We know that we have in the prefrontal cortex a class of inhibitory neurons called the parvalbumin expressing interneurons. They are inhibitory. They are quite interesting because those neurons follow high frequency stimulation, and they are the only one in the cortex to follow high frequency stimulation above 200 Hertz. And another property of these cells is that they project, they are highly divergent. One single PV cells can contact 1,000 of principal of excitatory neurons. So the strategy we developed was a strategy to activate those PV cells in order to inhibit in a precise temporal manner the activation of this excitatory neuron in the ascending phase of the oscillation. So before to do that, we just wanted to be sure that the 4 Hertz oscillation were associated with these defensive states. So what we have done first, we impose an analog stimulation, we artificially induce 4 Hertz oscillation in the prefrontal cortex using an analog optogenetic stimulation. As you can see here, we were able to induce the 4 Hertz oscillation, and the simple induction of the 4 Hertz oscillation induced a high freezing state in those animals, a high defensive state. And this was really specific of the frequency we use, because when we use the same artificial induction at 8, 2 or 12 Hertz, it was not working. So we got only an increase in defensive state when we use the 4 Hertz stimulation. So now come the final strategy. We decided to use a closed loop experiment combining recordings, behavior, and optogenetic stimulation. The idea was the following one. We were recording the animal. We first detected the behavioral state, whether they were freezing or not. We were recording the LFP and detecting whether we could record the oscillation and in which phase of the oscillation we were, ascending or descending phase. And if we had these three criteria validated, that is, the animal was freezing, we saw 4 Hertz oscillation, and we were in the ascending phase of the oscillation, we perform either an optogenetic stimulation or an electrical stimulation. And as you can see on these two examples with the opto or the deep brain stimulation, we were able to target the ascending phase of the oscillation each time. Namely, we were able to activate those PV at exactly during the ascending phase of the oscillation. And what is the effect of this manipulation? The result is that we observe a complete drop of freezing behavior in the animal that were stimulated either with the optogenetic or the deep brain electrical stimulation. So together, the recording of single unit activity, local field potential, and the application of optogenetics in this particular example help us to identify this biomarker of defensive states. And I would like to finish my presentation with that. I thank you for your attention, and I would be really happy to address any question you may have.
Thank you very much, Cyril, for this very comprehensive presentation. We do have a couple of questions already. First one, how many brain regions could you record at a time?
So it depends on which species. In rats, we can put more electrodes on the head, so we can record 4 to 5 structures simultaneously. In mice, a bit more tricky, so it can be 3, sometimes 4, depending on what you record exactly in which structure you record. But 3 or 4 structures are feasible in both species.
Thank you. So another question, this one is a bit long. I have a tool compound with poor PK and brain penetration, but I want to see its effect in a deep brain structure. Do you offer depth recordings in conjunction with a drug cannula to record from a subcortical area while locally applying the drug?
So the key point here is that you cannot inject the drug at the place where you make the recording, because this you will induce movement into the brain if you use pressure injection, and of course you will lose the cells you are recording. What you can do is to inject locally a drug and then record in a remote structure connected with the region where you have been injecting the drug. This is feasible. The other option that we have used in the past was to not use pressure injection but electrophoresis, and in this particular case you are injected directly the compound, but the compound needs to be charged to do this experiment, and in this particular case you can record simultaneously in the same region.
Okay, thanks. Also, do you offer optogenetic tagging of specific neural types during recording?
Sure, this of course depends on a specific mouse line that could express different recombinase. We have used in the past a lot of PV Cre mice where you can phototag PV expressing neurons. Though I need to mention that phototagging is really interesting because you identify precisely one cell type, either excitatory or inhibitory, but it's kind bit of time consuming. So sometimes it's better to use calcium imaging to identify those neurons compared to single units recording. The yield is much, much more important in the using calcium imaging.
Thanks. Now, how do you determine between the effect of driving the cell at 4 Hz versus the effect of disrupting higher frequency firing in the PV cells?
The effect of driving the cells at 4 Hz
versus the effect of disrupting higher frequency firing in the PV cells?
So the way we control that is that in the closed loop experiment I was describing, the pulse we were using was really, it was a short pulse. It was not constant excitation. It was a pulse of maybe 10 to 20 milliseconds. So it's a short activation. But you're right, we can, this short the idea is that this short activation this short pulse activate those PV cells that in turn inhibit the excitatory neuron that are surrounding those PV cells. So, okay, maybe the question was maybe related to the analog stimulation we perform. I'm not sure if it is that. So if your question is more related to the artificial induction of 4 Hz oscillation in the prefrontal cortex, For sure, this is linked to the changes in the activity of the PV neurons that inputs on many different excitatory neurons. So we cannot disentangle the two in this particular example. We just look at the net effect. That was the fact that we could record the analog stimulation.
Thanks, Cyril. Now, do you provide other optical neurophysiology methods, for example, calcium imaging, neurotransmitter release imaging, or imaging intracellular signaling?
So what you offer in the platform is calcium imaging, either with a single cell resolution using the miniscope or a fiber photometry. That's what we propose in addition to the classical single units and LFP recordings.
Thanks. What kind of dosing routes could you propose?
So we can. We have done experiment for clients using Peros administration, IP administration, and we can also use local administration through cannulas. That's the way we can. We can use any different routes of administration. But these, the one I mentioned, are the one we mainly use in the past.
Okay, thanks. Also, have you used this approach in genetically modified mice that can have spontaneous seizures?
So, of course, we can use that in those genetic modified mice. We have used some mice in the past that were displaying not spontaneous seizure, but we identify ictal spikes on those animals that are markers. It was Alzheimer APP mice. And in those mice, ictal spike are a marker of epilepsy that will develop later on. So we can specifically identify those ictal spikes and look at the effect of different compounds on those ictal spikes. We have also observed absent seizure in mouse line, edge mouse line, or rat lines, and you can also identify those large deflection in the signals that correspond to these absent seizure. So this is feasible, of course.
Okay. Do you have much experience recording from other areas, for example, midbrain regions, cerebellum, and basal ganglia?
So we have recorded from many regions. So among the different regions we are recording from, I mentioned prefrontal cortex, amygdala, different nuclei of the amygdala. We have done recordings in the basal ganglia. We have done recordings in the VTA, in the abenula, in the PAG, dorsal and ventral PAG, in the thalamus. We are experienced in a number of regions in the brain. There is some region where the recordings is much more tricky. Let's say the PAG, the periarticular gray, is a region where the recordings are a bit tricky, but we have managed to record some cells there as well.
Thanks, Cyril. Do you have access to all mouse lines that are available to academic labs?
So the facility, yes. Octopus is within a research institute, so we have access to all the mouse line that you can find in academic labs. So all the mice you can get at the JAX, we can go get those animals. And we have a huge facility. We have a breeding facility as well. So it's kind of convenient if we can import mice from JAX, or we can also import mice from direct the customers. They can send us their animals as well. And depending on the health status of the animal, of course, we need to check that. But there is many possibilities in Octopus.
Thanks, Cyril. What is the usual length for an in vivo electrophysiology study?
So classically, from the past study we have been doing, if you consider recordings, local field potential and single units simultaneously in 10 to 12 mice in a particular behavioral task, if you want, or without behavioral task, usually it takes between 6 and 8 weeks. So including the we design our own electrodes, or depending on the need of the client, of course, we can design different electrodes. So all in all, it takes around 8 weeks to perform such an experiment.
Okay, thank you very much, Cyril. It seems that we don't have any additional question at the moment, and I think we already went a little bit over the time. But thank you very much for taking the time to answer all the questions, and thank you for your presentation. Of course, everyone, you will have the opportunity to follow up and ask additional questions if you like. The webinar has now come to an end, and you will receive an email just after with the full recording of the session. Please share it with interested colleagues. Also, you can visit our website to make sure you register for our next webinars and fill out the quick survey right after closing the GoToWebinar windows to share your feedback with us. Thank you, Cyril, and thank you, everyone. And we look forward to seeing you at our next online event.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.